إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، أدى الأمانة وبلغ الرسالة ونصح الأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين. فصلوات الله وسلامه على خير من أرسل، سيدنا وأسوتنا ورسولنا ونبينا محمد، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تأسى به واتبع سنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم، اللهم آمين. إن خير الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وإن خير الأمور عزائمها، وشر الأمور محدثاتها. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم، إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم، يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت، وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها، وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. أما بعد، my dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran Kareem says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. And if you were to count the blessings that Allah ta'ala has given you, you will not be able to. There is no count for what He has given us. And not all blessings are in the same level. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the life, has given us the ability to breathe, has given us the health, has given us the children, the family, the jobs, the income. Regardless how much you count them, you're not going to be able to count them, but they are not all the same. Because there is one ni'mah, one blessing, that surpasses all of them. And that is better than all of them, which is the ni'mah to Islam, the guidance to Islam. The greatest ni'mah that Allah Ta'ala has given us is that He's guiding us to Islam. Because with that guidance, there is that knowledge of how to live, the knowledge what to expect after death, the knowledge that Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala is the master of everything. It is a nur. Allah Ta'ala called it a nur, that He Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala light that He has given us so that we can live our lives. أَفَمَنْ يَمْشِي مُكِبًّا عَلَى وَجْهِهِ أَهْدًا أَمَّنْ يَمْشِي سَوِيًّا عَلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Who is better? A person who walks and trembles and falls all over their faces, or somebody who's walking upright on a straight path? That's the example of a believer and a disbeliever. The one who walks on a straight path. It is this belief that makes the Muslim Ummah unique. It's what makes us different. It's not the colors, it's not the language, it's not the heritage, it's not the where we come from. It is this belief that makes us stand out and makes us the best of mankind, as Allah Ta'ala testifies to that. When He says, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You are the best ummah, not because they were from Quraysh, not because when they were Arabs, not because they were non-Arabs. Actually, the concept of ummah by definition that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought is a mix. It does not recognize boundaries of where you're from, of language, of color, of race. None of that mattered. What only mattered is La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that is the ni'mah that Allah Ta'ala has given us. And in this ni'mah, in part of this belief, just to show you how it sets the mindset, it sets the life of the Muslim, how that believer in this is different from anybody else. One part of our belief is that we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He subhanahu wa ta'ala, as an example, is He is al-Razzaq. Inna Allaha huwa al-Razzaq al-Mateen. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is He who is the sustenance provider, al-Mateen. That immediately makes the Muslim act very differently. Nobody controls my sustenance. Nobody controls my income. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sustenance provider. He is the sustainer. Therefore, I don't have to kiss up to anybody. I don't have to feel that I am less than anybody. Nobody controls me, and therefore, I only live according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I don't have to work in the haram. I do not have to have a haram living so that I can, because I don't have to stop praying you know, so to please my boss or to please the company I work with. Because Allah Ta'ala is the Razzaq. This belief sets the way that we act, the way we function. That our loyalty, our adherence, our belonging is to one, and that is Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Part of our belief as well is that Allah Ta'ala is the one who provides good, and He is the one who protects Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. What does He say, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala? وَإِن يَمْسَسْكَ اللَّهُ بِضُرٍ فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ. If Allah Ta'ala wills something harmful to befall on you, nobody can remove it but Him Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. But He. Nobody can remove it. So it doesn't matter how much you can ask people for help. If Allah Ta'ala willed it for you, it is going to happen. فَلَا كَاشِفَ لَهُ إِلَّا هُوَ وَإِنْ يَمْسَسْكَ بِخَيْرٍ. And He will, if He wants you to have goodness, something that is of good, فَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. He is the most capable of doing that. Who is going to stop Him from giving you the good when He wants Him Subhanahu, when He wants you Subhanahu wa Ta'ala? Who is going to stop Him to, you know, from putting harm on you if He that's what He wants Subhanahu wa Ta'ala? This is part of our belief. This is part of our aqeedah, how we view Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And in this, I would like to mention a hadith and really take a pause just with this hadith today. Just to remind you of where, how the Muslim is, and how the Muslim thinks, and how the Muslim behaves, and especially nowadays when really there are dark times, not only for the Muslims, for mankind, but we get it doubled. We get it doubled because we are accused of being the source of this darkness, and we are the ones who are spreading this ill-doing. And we need to remember these things in these bad times for Muslims, so that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala and His deen serve as a guidance for us, as a nur for us, so that we know how to function nowadays. Because unfortunately, the Muslims, and we have a lot of disturbances, a lot of conflicts in even how to respond to all, whatever situation that we are living in. Abdullah bin Abbas, radiallahu anhu, who was a child. Abdullah bin Abbas was born, you know, 3 years before Hijrah. Most reports, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died when Abdullah bin Abbas was either 9 or 10 years old. So he said, كنت خلف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. I was riding behind the رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he says, يا غلام, boy, إني معلمك كلمات. I'm going to teach you a few words. From a child who even at the time of رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم died, Abdullah bin Abbas, as I said, was 9, 10 years old. And رسول صلى الله عليه وسلم teaching him the following. He said, I'm going to teach you a few words. احفظ الله يحفظك. احفظ الله يحفظك. Be on the side of Allah Ta'ala. Keep the guidance of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Do not break the laws of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Be obedient to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Then what is the result? يحفظك. That He will protect you and He will keep you from harm. Not only you as a matter of fact, but you and also your offspring. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala did not specify He will only protect you on the day of judgment. He said, يحفظك. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, يحفظك. He will protect you. In all your affairs, He will protect you. He'll protect your deen, the greatest ni'mah that we have. He will protect you and protect that guidance when you keep with the laws of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. He will protect your income, He will protect your health, He will protect whatever you have. And really most deserving is your, He'll protect al-akhirah for you. But as I said, even your children are protected. In Surah Al-Kahf, it teaches us, you know, but when Musa alayhi salam was walking with, or was walking with the righteous man, and when he came to a wall that was about to collapse, فأراد أن ينقض فأقامه, so he put it back. قال لو شئت لاتخذت عليه جائزة. Why don't you take something for him? Look at the response of the righteous man. He says, أَمَّا الْجِبَالُ فَكَانَ لِغُلَامَيْنِ يَتِيمَيْنِ فِي الْمَدِينَةِ. As for the wall, it belonged to two orphan children. فِي الْمَدِينَةِ, in the city. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَا صَالِحًا. And their father was good. But they were still children. They didn't do any bad, any good. They're still children. But because of the righteousness of the father, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the well-being, protected the interest of the child. وَكَانَ أَبُوهُمَ صَالِحًا. This is a middle sentence that was put in the Quran al-Kareem to say, it's because of this that we are taking care of them. Their father was a righteous man. So when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects us, you know, when you keep with the laws of Allah, you keep protecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will protect you, protect your children, protect your offspring, you will protect your spouse, protect your family. And again, the biggest protection is that He protects your deen. Because the wealth can go, the children can go, the income can go, but if the deen goes, that's a disaster. Because then we have nothing to live by, and there is no akhirah for us. وَالْرِيَةُ بِاللَّهِ اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ يَحْفَظْكَ اِحْفَظِ اللَّهَ تَجِدُهُ تُجَاهَكَ That keep on the rights of Allah, keep protecting the rules of Allah, and you will find him تُجَاهَكَ or in another report, أمامك. You will find him in front of you. As a guidance, that he will be guiding you. And what is the best guidance of Allah Ta'ala has given us to show us right from wrong, but the halal and the haram, but the laws of Islam? That is what He subhanahu wa ta'ala has promised, that He will guide you through this life in the best way. Those people who protect the laws of Allah Ta'ala, protect their belief, protect their iman, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compliments in the Quran Kareem. He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, هَذَا مَا تُعَدُونَ لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظٍ. This is what you are promised for everybody who keeps coming back in repentance and who is keeping of what? Of our boundaries, of our laws. مَنْ خَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ Who fears the Rahman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful in the ghayb, وَجَاءَ بِالْقَلْبِ مُنِيبِ And he came with a turning, returning heart, etc. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards the person that Allah ta'ala will be with you all of the time. وَعْلَمْ أن لو اجتمعت الأمة على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بما كتب الله لك. And you should know if the entire nation gets together to benefit you with something, they will not be able to unless Allah Ta'ala has decreed it for you. If Allah Ta'ala has decreed it for you, then they are able to benefit you. واعلم أن لو أن الأمة لو اجتمعت على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك بشيء إلا وقد كتبه الله عليك. And if the entire Ummah gets together to harm you with something, they will not be able to harm you but with something which Allah Ta'ala has already decreed on you. Meaning the harm is not because of their effort. It's because Allah Ta'ala has already willed it. And the good is not because of their effort. It's because Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala willed it. Who is the mighty and who is nothing? Who is the one in control of everything and who is nothing? He's not worthy of mentioning. If all of us collaborate to do something good, we'll not be able to unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written it. And if all of us collaborate and cooperate and put all our efforts together to do something that's bad, we'll not be able to unless Allah ta'ala has written it. Then we are nothing. All our effort is nothing. The disbelievers' efforts are nothing. And the Muslims' efforts are nothing without the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's where the Muslim's heart is. That's where the Muslim's mind is. That's how the Muslim becomes different, a different human being. Because they know, that Muslim knows, that it is only Allah that you attach yourself to. Then it is strange when somebody reads such hadith. When somebody remembers these ayat, it is strange then when we see how the Muslims now are willing to compromise the greatest ni'mat Allah has given us. You look at many things that have happened. Muslims now, many of us are afraid even to pray in public. Well, Muslims are, now many of our sisters have decided to take off their hijab. Many of our sisters have decided to wear this modified, I will fit in kind of hijab, either with a baseball cap, or this hat, or this kind of this and that. I'm not talking about it from a fiqh point of view, from a student's point of view. The point is not that. But the point is that when you start debating and haggling over the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on your side? We will get to a point where we don't even know what Islam is. The latest thing is that we have one Muslim woman, one Muslim sister, decided to show up in Playboy. Yes, dressed in quote unquote, whatever she calls us, hijab. We are at that stage. If you check the social media, we have so many things that are talking about, I'm a Muslim, but I drink. I'm a Muslim, I don't pray. I'm a Muslim, and here's my girlfriend. I'm a Muslim, here's my boyfriend. To show that we are just like you, we're just like you, then where is the distinguishing Islam that we're taking pride in? If I'm sinning, if I'm doing something that's haram, that's between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But to say this is Islam, this is a sample, what Islam is, what it allows, etc. No, you can't. Because now you're speaking on behalf of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to understand that the pressure should not be met with lack of insistence on haq, lack of right standing on haq. It cannot be that way. When there is pressure, the Muslims stand tall and stand strong because they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, this very hadith, one report was reported by Tirmidhi, another one by Imam Ahmad. The one by Imam Ahmad has a different or additional statement at the end. In the end, it says, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ النَّصْرَ مَعَ الصَّبْرِ. You should know that victory comes with patience. He's still teaching a boy. At best, he's 10 years old. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells him, you should know that victory comes with patience, not with letting go. Not with letting go. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues and he says, وَإِنَّ الْفَرَجَ مَعَ الْكَرْبِ. And when there is hardship, there is ease. Allah ta'ala will bring it. And he said, مَعْ. It's in ma'iyya, means at the same time. When there is hardship, you have ease. Somebody who reads this, the sabr, patience, is not when you let go and you become patient. The sabr is when you hold tight to your beliefs, you hold tight to your deen, and you stand tall, and then you pay the price for it while holding tight to it. And then you say, I am patient. Until Allah Ta'ala brings that ease that He subhanahu wa ta'ala promised us to. وَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. As the Rasul صلى الله عليه وسلم continues in this report, وَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Indeed, with hardship, there is ease. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who hold their tight to their deen and never compromise their deen. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا لِهَا وَزَا مُسْتَغْفِرِينَ. استغفر الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على محمد النبي وفيه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear brothers and sisters, really due to the shortage of time, I'm cutting my khutbah short. But it's a very simple concept. There is always going to be people who call for something and people who oppose them, regardless what you call for. And in our case as Muslims, there's always going to be people who are calling for Islam and people who oppose them. And people who spread rumors, and people who will fabricate stories about you, and people who will put pressure so that you become like them. This is always the case. This has existed at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Actually, as a matter of fact, it existed before the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we remember the hadith al-Bukhari when al-Khabbab al-Arad came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And al-Khabbab al-Arad, just as an extra piece of information, al-Khabbab al-Arad, out of all the Sahaba, he is the man who was tortured so much so that to the point where his back became jumbled. The skin, because of the fire that was put on his skin, on his back, it became jumbled. So that man who was tortured so much comes to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he says, Ya Rasulullah, ala tad'u lana? Ala tastansiru lana? Why don't you make dua for us? Why don't you ask Allah Ta'ala to provide us victory? This is in Mecca. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sitting in the shade of the Kaaba, he got up. And when he alayhi salatu wa sallam got upset, his face changed and turned red. And he got upset because of the question. And he says, Wallahi, about Allah, كان الذين من قبلكم يشق أحدهم من منشار من مفرق رأسه إلى قدمين إلى نصفين يشق إلى نصفين. That the person, one of them, meaning the believers, would be sawn in half from the top of their heads until they become two. وَمَا يَرُدُّهُمْ ذَلِكَ عَنْ دِينِهِمْ شَيْئًا. And that will not turn them away from their deen. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ قَوْمٌ تَسْتَعْجِلُونَ. You're only in a rush. You always want things in a hurry. When Allah Ta'ala brings right the good, He will bring the good when He subhanahu wa ta'ala deems, when He sets it to be correct. But for us in these times, we should know that nobody can harm us. Nobody can benefit us of Allah but Allah. And when we start compromising our deen, the question that comes to us is, when will we draw the line? At what point we are accepting it? So today we don't pray. Tomorrow we also want to not to fast. You know, it is amazing really at this last Eid, when you have some Muslims, because it was a possibility that will go on the day of 9/11, and you have some Muslims suggesting, let's change it. And again, let's change the day so that it does not offend anybody. You know, there's a debate amongst the fuqaha whether you can pray the day before or the day after, etc., etc. You know, but that's a fiqh issue. But the reasoning is not sound. The reason is if I'm going to start changing my day of Ramadan and my day of Al-Hajj and my day of and the time of Salah and the time of this, the question is, where are we going to draw the line? The line should be drawn from the very top. There is no compromise in our deen. None of us owns the deen of Islam so that we can compromise over it. None of us does. We don't have, alhamdulillah, we don't have clergy and we don't have popes who sit in a direct communication with Allah Ta'ala to alter the deen. The deen is set. The deen is set. And at the end of the day, you will have people who hate, who will hate Islam and will hate the Muslims. And you'll have people who hate, you know, who love Islam and love the Muslims. You'll have people who hate seeing you pray. And you'll have people who will become Muslims because of the fact that they saw you pray. You'll have people who hate the sound of the adhan. And you'll have people who will become Muslims because of the sound of the adhan. This is a fact. This is a fact. To expect to please everybody is not going to happen. If Allah Ta'ala is pleased, what do we care about anybody else? And if Allah Ta'ala is angry, what do we care about anybody else? Our loyalty, our deen, the one we worship, belongs to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. We worship Allah alone. We seek the Akhirah. We are the Muslim Ummah, the Ummah of Islam, the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Just like we say at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about this Sahaba, رضي الله عنهم, we made dua for them, and we made the statement that Allah Ta'ala says, رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with us. Why can't we be also like them? Allah is pleased with us and we are pleased with Him, pleased with His deen, pleased with His rules, pleased with whatever He subhanahu wa ta'ala decides to be fit for us. That's a Muslim. And we should all aspire for that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lighten our hearts with the iman. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our hearts firm with the iman. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who understand the deen and spread the knowledge of the deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who fear none but Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who love nobody but Him subhanahu wa ta'ala and whom He tells us to love. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the best ummah. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honor the Muslim ummah with Islam again. And honor the Muslim ummah with glory and victory again. وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْعَزِيزِ.